Remember that there are three parts for these lectures. First part after theoretical introduction about second order work criterion. First part was to analyze failure by considering second order work criterion with phenomenological elastoplastic relations. First part, phenomenological analysis. Second part, micromechanical analysis with a micromechanical model. And third part, application of a numerical discrete element method to analyze failure in granular materials. I am just at the end of the first part. It means what kind of results have been obtained by applying second order work criterion to some elastoplastic constitutive relation. We have discussed yesterday morning axisymmetric condition. We have discussed very briefly plane strain condition, and now we are going to 3D condition. Here, this is a cut of the irregular hexagonal pyramid of Morcoulon by a plane perpendicular to the hydrostatic axis, perpendicular to the isotropic line in the principal stress space. The cut of Morcoulon pyramid gives you this irregular hexagon here in this plane perpendicular to the hydrostatic line. And here you have once more the first point where second order work is vanishing, or where the determinant of the symmetric part of the elastoplastic matrix is vanishing. It means that this domain here, between this more or less circle here and the irregular hexagon, this area here is the bifurcation domain for a dense sand, and here for a loose sand. You see that the loose sand is a little bit more unstable than the dense sand, and the bifurcation domain is larger for a loose sand than for a dense sand. And here this is a 3D view of the boundary of the bifurcation domain. Here, this is the boundary of the bifurcation domain in the principal stress, three-dimensional stress space. You see that for two different elastoplastic relations, you see that the conical structure of Morcoulon criterion is respected by the boundary of the bifurcation domain. The boundary is here, also here in a plane perpendicular to the hydrostatic line here in red. And here you have these instability cones for general 3D conditions. You see that these instability cones have quite a complex pattern. It means that for 3D condition, the bifurcation domain and the instability cones inside the bifurcation domain are varying in quite a complex manner along a given loading paths. The picture of failure, of unstable directions, in general 3D condition are not so simple. Here, this is same kind of results, but with the nonlinear model. We were able to demonstrate that for 3D conditions, the instability cones are elliptical cones, for incrementally piecewise linear elastoplastic relation. For completely incrementally non-linear elastoplastic relation, the cones are no more elliptic. You see that the cut of the cones by spheres gives you some this kind of potatoes here, which have no reason to have simple geometrical shapes. You see quite complex shapes in the general case of incrementally nonlinear elastoplastic relation. Okay, now second part, it means the application of a micro-mechanical model to this question of failure, of bifurcation in granular materials. I think it is interesting to discuss this micro-mechanical model because in the future this kind of model will be more and more important. Today we have at an international level probably 3 or 4 models based on micromechanics, but in the future there will be more and more model of this kind, and you will see that this kind of model can be really, really powerful. The idea is, of course, to introduce representative volume elements with some grains inside this representative volume elements. Here, the grains are spheres, or with around some spheres, and you have, as it is very classical, you have two scales, the granular scale where the proper variables are the intergranular force F and the intergranular displacement U, and at the frontier of the representative volume element, the proper variable are, of course, the macroscopic stress tensor and the macroscopic strain tensor. And the idea is to try to link these macroscopic variables, sigma and epsilon, to the internal force field and the internal displacement field. And the idea, like generally speaking in molecular dynamics, the idea is to consider only a very simple relation between the intergranular force F and the intergranular displacement U. This is, of course, the advantage of this method. The complexity of the macroscopic behavior is just due to the great number of spheres in interactions. Ourself in Grenoble, François Nico. There are other contexts where people are going from the sigma. You have the choice to go like that or like that. In our case, of course, you are. Because you have some spheres, the description of the granular assembly is quite simple. You define what we have called the contact directions between grains, the direction perpendicular to the tangent plane between two grains, and we have to define initially in a statistical manner the number of contact between grains in each space directions. You have to define with statistical tools the geometry of the granular assembly of at the beginning of your computation, and you have also to define statistical distribution of initial forces. After that, you assume to know the epsilon. Press the internal displacement field. For that, we are using what is called a strain localization operator. Because from a macroscopic variable to internal discrete affine assumption which is not the same. There is no except use an intermediate scale, and maybe I will discuss that a little bit later on. Anyway, by considering some strain localization operator, the simplest one, the classical one, you are able to express du from the epsilon. Of course, this step here is the most difficult step, because you have not a unique solution, and you know the epsilon at the frontier of the representative volume element, and you want to express the internal displacement field. That's a difficult question. After that, knowing the incremental displacement field du, you have to express the internal force field DF by considering a local behavior, a local intercellular behavior. This behavior is very simple. That's basic. And in some models, they are introducing here quite a complicated behavior. This is an error. This is an error. The success of molecular dynamics is to consider here a very simple. This is just an elastic constitutive relation, the simplest one. Just three mechanical parameters. An elastic stiffness coefficient, Kn, thermal direction, an elastic stiffness coefficient kT in the tangential direction, and a friction angle, a dry friction angle. Leonardo da Vinci friction angle between the grains. You have just a behavior like that. Very simple. Elastic plastic. Here, this is just the expression of the incremental tangential force by considering this limit value given by dry friction. Okay, now from the epsilon you have obtained du, from du you have obtained df, from df you have to obtain d sigma. This step here is perfect. This averaging operator here has been demonstrated by Love 1 century ago, and this relation has been obtained also by variational considerations. Don't ask me about variational approaches, but it has been properly demonstrated again a few years ago, and it has been verified very carefully with discrete element method. It works very well. Of course, here you have to differentiate this relation. You have to differentiate this relation by taking care on the fact that f is varying, n is varying, and you have to integrate with respect to the space direction. And finally, you see that you have now a macroscopic elastoplastic constitutive relation relating d epsilon to d sigma, and in this elastoplastic relation between d epsilon and d sigma, you have introduced a geometrical description of your granular assembly, but only 3 mechanical parameters. Have in mind that the phenomenological elastoplastic relation I have developed myself in Grenoble, and you have seen the results. The results are quite nice. This law is quite powerful. But in my own model, I have something like 15 parameters for simple behavior. And if I want to describe a cyclic behavior, I need 18 parameters. And it's the usual case in for geomaterials, elastoplastic relations, powerful phenomenological elastoplastic relations have around 15 parameters. These parameters are difficult to calibrate. It costs a lot of money in practice to obtain these parameters. This is not a good solution to describe the behavior of a complex material like geomaterial. Here you see that you have only 3 mechanical parameters, very easy to determine, very easy to obtain, to measure. Here the difficult point is this step. It appears today that probably by going directly to the macroscopic scale, to the continuum mechanics scale, to the intergranular scale, it's too difficult. And the idea was to introduce between microscopic scale and macroscopic scale, to introduce a mesoscopic scale and intermediate scale. I have now a paper with Nico submitted to Mechanics of Material, where we are waiting for the reviews, where we have introduced an intermediate structure constituted by six grains, an hexagon of six grains. With six grains, you can compute all the forces, the displacement by an analytical way. And probably with this mesoscopic scale here, we will be able to enrich this this relation, and probably to improve the relation. But anyway, even with quite a simple micromechanical model, we are able, of course, to obtain a macroscopic Morcoulon failure criterion, to obtain a dilatant behavior, to obtain plastic strains, to obtain a complex behavior. Do you have any question about the micromechanical model? Because now we will see some applications of this model in relation with second order work criterion. Yeah. This is a local reasoning. Your representative volume element is a material point from a continuum mechanics point of view. This is just a material point. It means
as previously with the phenomenological elastoplastic relation, by considering some stress state, or here some strain state for axis symmetric condition, and check the sign of second order work in each strain direction. And the results are here. This is a polar representation of second order work. It means that in this, this is a stress plane for axis symmetric condition. Here, this is a stress state, and in each stress direction, you plot the value of second order work as the length of this vector in this stress direction, for example. And you plot the directional variation of second order work with respect to stress direction in this polar diagram for different stress levels. You know this, you see that the stress level is the deviatoric stress level is quite low, Q sigma 1 minus sigma 3 divided by B, the mean pressure, sigma 1 plus 2 sigma 3 divided by 3. You see that you are more or less close to the hydrostatic line. This stress state is not so deviatory, and you see that this is a blue curve. The second order work is not at all vanishing. Then the deviatory stress level is increased here with the green curve, and you see that the second order block is almost vanishing in this direction, and here this is the stress level at the boundary of the bifurcation domain, where the second order block is vanishing first in this stress direction here. When a polar curve, polar diagram is passing through the origin, it means that the scalar variable is equal to zero. And you have here a comparison between the micromechanical model, which is called the microdirectional model, and the elastoplasty, the phenomenological elastoplastic model I have just discussed previously at the front of you. You see that you have quite a nice qualitative agreement, not a quantitative agreement, of course, but a nice qualitative agreement. It means that with this micromechanical model, we are able to describe this kind of bifurcations. And what is interesting now with the micromechanical model, not only the fact that there are few mechanical parameters inside a micromechanical model, but what is very interesting is the fact that now you can go to the grain scale and see at the grain scale why the second order work is vanishing. Because in a micromechanical description, you know what happens at the grain scale. And with this particular model, it appears that the second order work can be decomposed in three terms. A local second order work, I will discuss that just now. A term which is linked to the change in the volume of the representative volume element, and a term which is linked to the change in the fabric. It means creation or loss of contacts. It appears that both these terms here are not so important, and the first one is the most important. The first one is very interesting. It has been called the local second order work because you see that this is the discrete second order work which appears here. DF scalar DU. DF scalar DU, this is exactly the expression of local second order work between two grains at the contact point. If you consider the particle, you have to add the moment DC scalar d omega. Omega is the rotation at the contact point, the torsor is just a force. And okay, you see here this discrete second order work integrate, of course, in all the space directions. And it was possible in an analytical manner to obtain the conditions where the local, the discrete second order work between two grains is vanishing. The results are not so simple because we are in a general fluidic condition. What is clear is the fact that you have to decrease the normal displacement or the normal force. You have seen that the codes with previous phenomenological analysis, the goals are directed towards the origin of the stress play or the three-dimensional stress space. And here, with this negative value of the normal displacement or the normal force, and you remember that both are proportional, just linked by an elastic normal stiffness coefficient, you see that also between two grades, the equivalent of the cones are also directed towards the origin with negative value of the incremental displacement. In 3D, the results are not so simple. In 2D, it's very simple. Just consider this, this experiment. You have here a box. You put here some mass in order that you are just at the limit equilibrium for the box on the table. And you see that if you apply now a small force DF like that, because you decrease the normal components, if you stay, of course, if you just decrease like that, your box will slide like that, and you will have du scalar df equal to zero. But you can even have a small force like that and have a displacement like that. And in this situation, df scalar du is of course strictly negative. Huh? It means that in 2D conditions, that's easy to perform an experiment with negative value of the discrete second order problem. Jean Mandel, the French father of mechanics, French people told me that Jean Mandel, with this kind of experiment, was explaining that a peasant with a pig, a story told by Jean Mandel half a century ago, when the peasant is pulling the pig, and the pig was resisting, Jean Mandel was explaining that the peasant has just to decrease a little bit the weight of the pig to make the pig coming with the peasant. This is the story by Jean Mandel with the peasant and the pig to explain why with a negative second order work it's possible to make the pig slide. Okay.
Excuse me. Why do you call second order work and not simply work? What is the reason?
You know that the element that work is defined by sigma ij, the epsilon ij, and Hill has called second order work d sigma, the epsilon. But of course, the system. not the second derivative. This is second order work because this is a product of
to infinitesimal
first order by your first order, and you obtain second order. But probably the name is not perfect because this is not the second derivative. But Hill has called, Hill, Mandel, and so on have called this expression second order work. I think that it will not be fair to change the name. Anyway, this is a quantity of second order.
Okay, this is it.
But from a mathematical point of view, this is not a second derivative of the energy. Okay. Let's go now to the discrete element analysis. Third part. The discrete element analysis is a numerical method. But as we have already discussed, not purely a numerical method, but like the finite element method. The finite element method, this is purely a way to discretize a continuum medium. Discrete element model is a numerical method, but it is based, as generally speaking, molecular dynamics, on this idea that you can have only simple interaction laws between the grain, the particles, the molecules, and so on. The intergranular law is the same as in the micromechanical model. It means a very simple intergranular relation. Always this elastic stiffness coefficient in the normal direction. Once more, this elastic tangential stiffness coefficient in the tangential direction, and the friction. We have developed in Grenoble our own discrete element model. The first model in Grenoble was called STEG. Now we have changed the name because the code has been developed largely. The new name of the code is YEN. YEN is an open source code, discrete element code. You can obtain YEN very easily on the corresponding website, and it is free of charge and so on. Now many people are developing YEN. YEN is applied, for example, today in Australia to analyze the stability of the large Australian open mines. YEN is applied to fracture cliffs. Of course, YEN is applied to granular assemblies. We have put now water inside YEN. We can describe non-saturated granular materials and so on. And there are many different applications. The idea of discrete element method is very simple. You consider a great number of grains. It can be spheres, but in YEN now you can glue together some spheres and obtain grains of different shapes. You can have, you can make something like that and obtain a grain which has this this shape here. It means that if you want, you can consider spherical grains or another kind of shapes for the grains. You can also have some irregular blocks like that, and so on. The idea is very simple. You have, for example, a cubical specimen. You apply some displacement at the boundary. The positions of the grains are changing. Because the position of the grains are changing, you are able to compute the new forces applied to the grains by using second Newton law. For each grain, you have F equal to M multiplied by the acceleration. You know the displacement. You deduce F, the force, by considering this local interaction law. Knowing F, you compute gamma, the acceleration. You integrate two times gamma. You obtain displacement, new position, new force, and so on. Displacement, acceleration, displacement, forces, new forces, acceleration, integration, speed, velocity, displacement, and so on. And you iterate until you obtain the equilibrium. It means no more grains moving inside your sample. In Grenoble, we are considering here 10,000 spheres with a normal BC, with more advanced computers. You can consider without particular difficulty 100,000 grains, but I have discussed recently with a research director of Caterpillar. You know Caterpillar, an American company which has a big research center in the north of America, close to the border with Canada. In Caterpillar, they are performing in a quite usual way. This kind of computation with 10 million of grains, 50 million of grains. Of course, with the development of the power of computers, that will be possible to make not completely practical computation with discrete element method, but anyway, not so far. EDF in France, you know EDF as a French company of electricity, EDF has performed the first discrete element computation of a dam. Of course, it was a small dam, but probably that in the future, this method will be applied to real boundary value problem of engineering interest more and more. Here we have just considered a cubical specimen with 10,000 spheres. Of course, 10,000 spheres, that's enough to obtain a continuum mechanics description of a granular assembly.
Excuse me.
Yeah.
The springs are in point of contact that are evaluated time by time.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. And when the contact is lost, no more intergranularity.
Okay,
and you can have creation of contacts or losses of contacts, of course, which complicate a little bit the iterations. But it converges. The question of uniqueness is not clear.
Unilateral studies are good.
But why the uniqueness is not
it was. And Jean-Jacques Moreau in Montpellier with a completely different numerical method by considering convex mathematical analysis. Jean-Jacques Moreau in Montpellier has developed his own code with no more spring, just a rigid particle. With this method, it is possible to consider rigid particle. It will not obtain the convergence of your iteration.
This is a good signal. This is a good feature of your model.
That it is not converging for rigid particle.
Because with rigid particles, you don't have well-defined stress.
Okay.
And if you have contact between rigid particles, it is a very good signal that your code is not converging.
Okay.
And you have not well posed problems.
Okay. Jean-Jacques Moreau with another method, rigid particle, convex analysis, and only dry friction coefficient was also able to perform this kind of computation with 10,000 spheres. But of course, this code, this method, this discrete element method is perfect if you have not grains with too large relative motions. But with the Jean-Jacques Moreau method with the rigid grains is not good, for example, for an odometric compression or an isotropic compression in very bad with rigid grains. The granular assembly is immediately blocked and so on. But Jean-Jacques Moreau code is perfect, for example, to simulate a seismic event on a Greek column. Huh? You have a Greek monument. Huh? You have a column like that. Huh? This nice Greek sculpture with a seismic event here, the basis, and with Jean-Jacques Moreau code, you are able to see the block moving, then going down, and so on. It's more difficult here because if you have too many particles without contacts, that's a little bit more difficult. Anyway, for to simulate lab experiments, this is perfect. Okay. Same kind of computation of numerical procedure now to check the sign of second order work criterion. It means that we are here in an axisymmetric condition, triaxial compression, and for different stress level, we check the sign of second order work in each stress direction. The results are here. This is not exactly a polar representation. We have called that a circular representation because we add to the second order work value a positive constant C in order that to have always positive values for the sum of second order work plus C. You know that polar diagrams are good for positive scalar variables. Of course, if the scalar variable is taking negative values, that's difficult. With this circular representation, it's possible to see the negative values. This circle, on this circle here, the second order work is vanishing, taking negative values inside and positive values outside. And as previously, you have the values here on second order work in each stress dimensions. And you see that we are once more again these cones of unstable direction here. And also in a very nice qualitative agreement with the previous instability cones obtained by experiments, by phenomenological elastoplastic analysis, by a micromechanical model, and here obtained with this, this discrete element method. Here, we have tried to compare quantitatively phenomenological elastoplastic relation and discrete element model with respect to these bifurcations. It means that we have calibrated the phenomenological incrementally nonlinear constitutive relation on numerical triaxial compressions. By considering this cubical specimen, we apply in lab test some triaxial compression, and having obtained these numerical behavior of this cubical specimen for great preaxial compression, we were able to calibrate the phenomenological constitutive relation on this numerical behavior. It means that we have now a phenomenological elastoplastic relation for this cubical specimen, for this virtual numerical cubical specimen. And we can compare in a quantitative way the frontier, the border of the bifurcation domain, and the instability codes given by the phenomenological elastoplastic relation and given by the discrete element problem. Here, we are always in an axisymmetric condition. Here, this is the Bordeaux line, the hydrostatic line, the isotropic line, and here, this is the first unstable direction. Here, this is the limit, the boundary of the bifurcation domain for this triangular assembly of spheres, and here, instability goals obtained by the elastoplastic correction, and here you have the instability goals given by the discrete element model. Here this is the boundary of the bifurcation domain for the discrete element model, and here for the phenomenological relation. You see that for some points, not any code was obtained. It means that with the discrete element model, you have the same dispersion of results as in an experimental test. And of course, the numerical specimen are not the same statistically from a geometrical point of view as in the real world. It means that you have more or less the same number of particles, more or less the same density as for specimens, true sample in the real world, but the results are not exactly the same. Now, what is interesting with the discrete element model, and I think this is an important point for you, what is interesting with a discrete element model is the fact that we can investigate failure. That's a big difference with the finite element method. Finite element method, as you know, has many difficulties to describe failure. Probably because finite element method is perfect for elliptic equations as in elasticity, but as you know, in perfect elasticity, we have hyperbolic equations, and probably finite element method is not so good for hyperbolic equation, or not so good to describe the transition from elliptical equation to hyperbolic equation. Anyway, finite element method has many difficulties to describe failure. Why? For a discrete element model, failure is quite a natural phenomenon, nothing particular in relation with failure. And you will see that with a discrete element method, we are able to obtain in detail the features of failure. And it means that we were able to check the theoretical condition to obtain failure. You know what is interesting with a PhD student? That's the fact that, at least in France, but I suppose it's true everywhere, don't believe the professor, and it's perfect. Luc Sibyl, with his discrete element model, told me, "Your story about second order or failure, I don't believe it. How it is possible to obtain failure in this course, and so on." And I don't know if this discrete element method will be able to describe all that, but just try. And you will see the results are absolutely impressive. The first point, it was his first computation in relation with second order law, was to check this question of control parameters. He has considered Pu constant grid test. You remember that I have introduced at the beginning of this lecture experiments corresponding to Q constant grid test. And according to the theory and to experimental results, and you have seen these experimental results at the beginning of the lectures. For a loose sum, a Q constant grain test produce some unexplained failure before Norplan plastic limit condition. This Q constant grain test in this diagram here corresponds exactly to this stress direction. The stress direction here in this diagram corresponds exactly to the Q constant grain test. You remember that on this Q constant grain test, dQ equals zero. It means decimal 1 minus decimal 2 equals zero. It means that we have, because of the axisymmetric condition, d sigma 1 equal to d sigma 2 equal to d sigma 2 négative. You have seen that according to the experimental results, you have some extremum value for epsilon d. It means that according you you remember, we have dq d epsilon v equal the elasticity matrix d epsilon 1 d sigma 3, I think so. And we have seen that according to the experiment, according to the theory, for Q constant weight test, if epsilon v is passing through a maximum, we will have a bifurcation bound at this maximum. It means that this Q constant grain test, if it is totally stress controlled, will go until the Morpoulon failure line, but if it is dilatancy control, volume variation control, it will not be able to pass the peak. According to the experiments, I have shown to you these experiments at the beginning of this lecture, and according to the theory, if this path is stress controlled, you will be able to pass this peak and to go to Morpoulon-là, but if you are volume variation control, you will not be able to pass this peak. Exactly like for a drain preaxial compression, for a drain preaxial compression in on a dense curve like that, if you are axially strain control, you pass the peak. But if you have axially force control, you will have a rupture in. Same thing, except that here this is a little bit more complicated because the limit state is not a stress state in a preaxial state, but the limit state is a state in volume variation. The material cannot sustain any additional volume variation. And the experimentalist at this dilatancy maximum, the experimentalist, many years ago, were just injecting a small amount of water with a syringe. And they obtained failure without any explanation at this time, certain failure at the maximum of the volume variation. It means that according to the experiment, according to the theory, if the sparse is stress controlled, nothing will happen. If the sparse is dilatancy controlled, you will obtain fragile. And Lux Civil has just considered this pure constant Gwen test with a totally fully stress controlled and with a dilatancy control, a small imposed dilatancy. If there is a maximum of dilatancy, he will not be able to pass through. The results are here. You see that when the path is a stress control, d sigma 1 equal to d sigma 2 equal to d sigma 3 negative, nothing happens. And when the path is dilatancy control, volume variation control, with an imposed value of d epsilon v, you see that for the strain, it's a strain here, huh? Yeah, for the strains, you have this exponentially growing strains, this burst of kinetic energy here, and the stresses are no more controllable. Huh? The stresses are decreasing, you are not able to respect the loading you want to impose to the sample. You have a true failure here with this growing stress, burst of kinetic energy, and stresses no more controllable. And this burst of kinetic energy, which is seen here, I have shown to you that from a theoretical point of view, we have a clear link between second order work and kinetic energy.
These are numerical data.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Of course, they do not depend upon the
numerical result obtained on this cubical specimen of 10,000 spheres. You apply triaxial compression, then there's a Q constant Gwen test, stress control, totally fully stress control, or control partly in a stress, partly decreed as equal to zero, and the epsilon V equal to a given constant. Hein? Same loading paths, Q constant Gwen test, but with two different set of control parameters of loading variables. Like, it's just a generalization of what happens in classical triaxial compression. If you have force control, you will not be able to pass any peak and you will have failure at the force peak. Here, this is a generalization. You have a generalization described by second order of criterion, you can have limit stress, limit states which are not stress states, but here volume variation limit states. And you see that the details of the feature of well, I have called diffuse failure because you have not any localization. I have called that diffuse failure. Maybe I will present briefly the application to landslide, and we will see the diffuse failure. But that's not so important. Okay, Lux Civil has verified now the question of control parameter, the influence of control parameter, but that's not the most important point. It was his first check. The second important point is the question of cones. Is it possible to obtain these cones of constant? stable direction with a discrete element model. And here he has checked this question of code. He has considered these proportional strain loading paths I have considered previously with a phenomenological elastoplastic analysis. And maybe you remember I have used this example of proportional strain loading paths in axisymmetric condition to show you that there are two solutions for R for the direction of the path. It means that we have a code of unstable direction, two direction where the second order work is vanishing, negative values inside the cone, positive values outside the cone. Here he has considered the same paths with some value of R which correspond to direction outside of the cone and some values of R inside the cone. For these extreme values we are outside of the cone, for both these values here we are inside the cone, and for these intermediate values here we are more or less close to the border of the cone as obtained previously. And he has this control parameter in order to be able to obtain failure if failure is possible. Okay, so the results are here. For this extreme value, blue and orange, you are outside of the cones. You see that orange and blue are here, nothing happens. Black and red, you are clearly inside the cone. You see that you have these large values of the strains and no more controllable stresses. And for purple and green, you are just close to the border of the cone, and you see that this erratic response here, this random response here at the border of the cone. It means that according to this discrete element model, we have truly some cones of unstable direction. Here, this is the same. Here you have the strains, large values of the strains for black and red, nothing outside of the cone, and some intermediate variation close to the border of the cone. And now I have shown to you that these failure states are bifurcation states, and because you have a change of regime from a static regime to a dynamic regime with continuous variation of the loading parameters, and that's the classical definition of bifurcation in physics. A sudden change in the state of the system, in the shape of the system, for continuous variation of the state variables, the loading parameters. We know from modern physics that bifurcation states are sensible to perturbations. And this is a feature of the bifurcation state. It will depend on some perturbation. And this question is checked now with more. more or less the same kind of values here for some direction outside of the code, for direction inside the code, for direction close to the boundary of the code, and we put a small perturbation. This perturbation was a small input of kinetic energy. You know, in these discrete element perturbations, we don't take into account the gravity. It means that the grains are not at all any way. And during the computation, you have among your 10,000 spheres, you have always a few grains which are floating. Just for a given increment, 4, 5, 10 grains have not any contact with any grains around Z. Luxibilla just put a finite speed, a finite velocity to these floating grains. For loading paths outside of the cone or inside the cone. Which are the results? First, you see that the perturbation here is so small because that's an input of kinetic energy, so small that it is not visible on this picture. Okay, blue and orange, you are outside of the cone, you see that the perturbation changes a little bit the kinetic energy, but finally the cubical specimen is again in equilibrium. Inside the cone, black and green, now the colors are not the same. Black and green, you see this burst of kinetic energy here, and the stresses are no more controllable. And close to the boundary of the cone, these intermediate values here, you have this peak of kinetic energy, but finally we reach again an equilibrium state. Here, no more any equilibrium state was reached. The cubical specimen was really failed. Okay? We have not the screen. Here was the conclusion. I think that what is important to remember is the fact that today micromechanical description and discrete element model are tools very interesting to investigate granular materials, porous materials, biomaterials, and so on. All these materials which are not so well described by the existing phenomenological theories. And probably in the future, discrete element method will be also applied to real boundary value problems. The second point is that for non-associated elastoplastic material, the question of failure has to be revisited. And we have no more a single plastic limit surface. We have a domain of bifurcation with very different mode of failure inside this this domain. And second order work criterion is an interesting criterion because if we accept, I have already told that to you, if we accept Flutter instabilities, it is the first criterion to be met, and it contains the other classical criteria. It means that from an engineering point of view, if second order work is positive for each stress direction or strain direction, any kind of failure cannot be expected. And that's an important point from an engineering point of view. And with second order work criterion, you will be able also to describe localized plastic strain, shear bands, and so on. We have observed clearly that inside some shear bands, second order work is taking negative values. Ah, okay, here you have. There are many papers, many recent papers on this question. You will find all that on Google Scholar and so on. And you have a book published with Yanis Varoulakis. This book corresponds to a schism school organized with Varoulakis some years ago. Okay, maybe I have a few minutes to see the example of one landslide, the true one landslide, the Italian landslide of Petacelo. I will go fast in order to finish in 5 or 10 minutes. I will not discuss Trevoux landslide, I will discuss only Petacelo landslide. Here you have some views of some degradations linked to this landslide. You see that this is a true landslide. Here you have the location of the landslide. Not so far from here, we are more or less here in the south of Roma. This is just maybe you know this landslide of Petacelo.
There are so many.
Okay.
Three per day.
Because here there is a motorway, there is a national road, there is a railway, and so on, some villages. 7 kilometers, and then this is a big landslide. And what is very interesting, at least for the research, is the fact that the slope is very flat. You see 6 degrees as an average value for the slope angle.
So Coulomb tells us
it is stable. Even by taking into account the water will decrease the friction angle. Maybe you can have a friction angle of 20 degrees, but 6 degrees, it's impossible. I just want to tell you a story. I have been called by the chapter of the American Society of Civil Engineers in Ohio, close to Cincinnati, in the States, to see a landslide. This landslide has destroyed 8 very big American houses just during their construction. Some houses were just finished, the other were just at the beginning of the construction. It means that the cost was terrible. Huh? 8 very big American and very luxurious American houses, the cost is terrible. That's the reason why there has been some disputes and so on. And a lot of measurement have been performed. The best American companies working in soil mechanics have been asked, and so on. I have seen the final report. This landslide has a slope of 14 degrees, not 6 degrees, 14 degrees. In conclusion of this report, it was written that according to all the existing method, it was impossible to explain this landslide. By measuring, and it was a conclusion of the report, by measuring the friction angle of the soil with preaxial test, shear test, with ring, with torsional apparatus and so on, the friction angle was not so. I don't remember exactly the friction angle, something like. Not so high, 27, 28, something like that. And the report concludes that, okay, we can make some errors about the friction angle, but not by taking into account the water, they arrive to 24 degrees. By taking into account the influence of saturation of water. The conclusion was it is impossible to make an error of 10 degrees about the friction angle. And, okay, the existing methods are not able to consider this kind of thing. We are using in Grenoble a finite element code developed by Liège University in Belgium. Here this is the plastic limit condition. Here this is the hardening variable. If you want to obtain these cones of unstable direction, two ingredients, that's very clear today, two ingredients are necessary. First, to have a non-associated plastic behavior. That in mind, F, the yield surface has to be different from the plastic potential, and second, to have hardening parameters. Of course, if you are elastic until the failure, you will never have negative values of second order work in an elastic domain. You need hardening parameters. This very simple plastic correlation, Plasser, implemented in this. Finite element code developed by Liège University is non-associated and has hardening parameters. Here, this is the hardening parameters. Here, this is a very simple elastoplastic relation. You have a few parameters. You see here that this is a calibration of this elastoplastic model. Here, this is the experimental results. Here, the results given by the calibration of this elastoplastic model.
Calibration with in situ or lab?
Lab test. This is preaxial lab test. You see that this model is very simple. It means that the calibration is not perfect, but that's not so important. What is interesting from a solid mechanism point of view is the fact that you have here some leaves like dense soil, and here you see a big contractancy during preaxial shearing, like for a very loose sand. Maybe this is the reason why this landslide appears. Of course, we are not everywhere landslide with a slope of 6 or 7 degrees. Maybe this is this quite strange behavior with respect to volume variation, which explains these instabilities. The idea was to take into account the separation of the throat. You have two main triggering factors for landslide. One is cystic events, the second is a strong renfall. And in Italy, you have more or less both.
Strong?
Rainfall, strong rainfall landslide. And in Italy, you have also some cystic event, probably inducing some landslide. I don't know what's that. The idea in Petacciato, rainfalls are probably the most important triggering factor. The idea was to simulate the separation of the slow due to this rainfall. And for that, we have to take into account and, the behavior of insulinable soil. I will not discuss that. All the ingredients for modeling with a phenomenological model and unsaturated soil. Okay. According to the theory, if you consider a material form, and until now I have considered only material form, or representative volume element, what is important is this local values of second order form. But if you have a boundary value problem, you have to integrate second order form in your whole body, in your whole mass you are considering. And it means that in the finite element method, you have to integrate the local values of second order form by taking into account the area of the local okay, here you have the loading procedure. The initial state is unsaturated, then we describe a progressive saturation of the slow by increasing the water table level and checking. Okay. Here you have Pedal Chateau. Here this is the level of the water table. We simulate a saturation not by a flux of water from outside, that's a little bit more complicated, but just by increasing the water level table. And you see that the negative values of second order work are more or less blue. You see progressively decreasing values of second order work. Not so big area of negative values, but it means that, and now it's quite classical, it means that the local values of second order work gives you the unstable zone. But the local values are not able to answer the question, is the slow unstable or not? For that, you have to consider the global value. And this global value will play the role of a security factor or something like that. And here you have the global value of second order work. You see that it is not really vanishing. We are not so far to have vanishing value. I am, of course, by changing a little bit the cohesion or the friction, you would have been able to obtain exactly zero here. But I have asked the student Vilcoa to not change any parameters. I don't want to obtain exactly zero in this numerical simulation. But it's clear that the global second order work is decreasing, and it's very close to zero. These results have been obtained without any change in the consecutive parameters. Not any. I don't want to obtain results which are not reasonable. It's not reasonable with such a calibration, and we have seen that the calibration is more or less approximate. It's not reasonable to obtain exactly zero. But we have here quite a nice description of the unstable zone, and we have here an explanation, a mechanism of this failure mode without any shear bands. Okay, I will stop here.
Before they say anything, show some collaboration.
Absolutely. Thank you for your...